Boldwood presents. Alvis Croft and Boldwood present. The 6pm Frazzled Mums Club. Written by Nina Manning. And read by Rebecca Norfolk. The moral right of the author has been asserted. This performance is owned by Boldwood. Chapter 1. Sophy. It was precisely 3 minutes past 9 a.m. on Wednesday, the 7th of September, when Sophy finally lost all decorum outside Oak Hill Primary Academy. A few other parents and carers, who were still in the vicinity, who also couldn't bear to step outside the school gates just yet for fear of being the furthest they had ever been from their 4- and 5-year-old children in as many years, turned and looked on. Some with empathy for the sudden outburst, some with fear, as if just looking at Sophie's wailing would make it contagious. Those hurried away. Sophie stood and looked at the care package she had been handed by the teacher, Mrs. Williams, when she walked Max into his classroom 10 minutes ago. A tea bag and a chocolate coin wrapped in a piece of paper. Sophie let the tears fall freely, her other hand pressed to her chest, as though that might help the pain that was searing through her and tearing her heart in two. Max was only 4 years old. Saying goodbye to him wasn't the hard part. The hard part was that she wouldn't get to know everything he had done all day. The harder part was that he wasn't her baby anymore. He was a big boy, Mummy, as he told her regularly, which hurt her heart more than she would admit to anyone. Over the last 4.5 years, Sophy had become used to saying goodbye to Max. Fortunately for her, though, it was so sporadic that she only had to put up with the crushing feeling in her chest once a week at the very most. When Sophy had first moved out when Max was a baby, her ex, Jeff, would call around all the time, trying to assert his fatherly rights as often as he could. There she was, alone in the 2-bedroomed flat Aisha and Mel had helped her move into after she left Jeff, and they would dance around each other on the doorstep, her handing him a neatly packed nappy bag, him trying to avoid eye contact. Occasionally, in those early days, he would show up unannounced and demand to see Max. Sophy would allow him his time, but because she was still breastfeeding, he would take Max to a cafe and bring him home exactly an hour later, looking like a man who had just completed a triathlon. His usually slick blonde hair would be ruffled and out of place. His shirt would have sick or coffee spilled on it, and the once neatly packed nappy bag would have used wet wipes, bottles and sippy cups falling out of it. He would deliver Max back with relief seeping into his expression. By the time she'd stopped breastfeeding Max, Jeff had already begun to lose interest in him, and the mystery woman whose face cream had taken up residence on Sophie's side of the bed was never mentioned. Later on, a few women's names were dropped into conversation until Debbie came along and didn't leave for a while. Debbie had been good for Jeff, and Sophy had even felt herself warm to her. Knowing there was a constant female presence in Jeff's house whenever Max went there to stay was a slight comfort. "I'll get on better with him when he's walking, and I can kick a ball around with him," Jeff said as Max began to toddle and went from a babe in arms to becoming a real handful. "Kick a ball around?" Sophy had asked. "Jeff, there's more to being a dad than kicking a ball around." The one area Jeff always came through was financial support. She could never fault him for the generous allowance that he put in her bank account every month, and never once questioned what she did with the money. Although Sophy was doing pretty well on her own. The 3 a.m. Shattered Mums podcast had hit the ground running with 14 series under her belt. Sophy could never have imagined that meeting two strangers outside a cancelled mother and baby group could have led to anything, let alone a wonderful friendship between her, Aisha, and Mel, which had not only helped her through the night feeds, but had also given her the inspiration to create an actual 3 a.m. Shattered Mums Club online. Sophy had almost 1 million followers on Instagram, and she had just begun designing merchandise. She was also looking into retreats where mums could escape the madness for a few days and just be with their babies. The 3 a.m. Shattered Mums Club had become an overnight success, with Mel and Aisha occasionally popping on the socials and the podcast to support Sophy.
"Oh God, he's really gone,"
My baby boy is now... Sophy looked across the playground and felt the tears welling again, and anyone might have thought she was completely bonkers and speaking to herself. But then she bent down and picked up the soft toy rabbit that was on the floor and turned and handed it to the little girl in the pushchair. There you go, Poppy. Mama's sad. Yes, darling, Mama is sad. I'm going to miss Max today. Will you miss him? Poppy nodded fiercely. Her strawberry blonde locks shook because Poppy always put so much emphasis on everything she did. It was the personality trait that overrode anything else about her, although there was much to love. But it was Poppy's earnestness that accompanied most things she said or did that made her stand out from other little people her age. It was a trait that Sophy believed Poppy had inherited from her father, who was dedicated, committed, and the hardest working individual she had ever known. And just at exactly the point Sophy thought she might fall to her knees next to Poppy's pushchair and cry some more, her phone rang, and she knew it would be him. She looked at the screen, and her heart soared, and her stomach did a microflip as she saw Niall's name was on the screen. "Hi," Sophy said, the sadness still thick in her voice. "How'd it go?" Niall's voice came through urgently, yet the softness of his Irish accent soothed her, the way it had the very first time she had heard it, that day on Jeff's doorstep when he arrived to build the extension. "Did the little man go in okay?" As though Sophy had been holding it all in, as if those first few tears had been a prelude to what had been brewing, Sophy now finally let rip and sobbed loudly and unapologetically. And Niall waited patiently on the other end until Sophy had calmed down. "I take it didn't go well," Niall said.
"No, it was fine. He was fine."
"Oh, right, so you're crying happy tears." Niall sounded confused.
"No, I'm crying because..."
Sophy paused, intent on holding it together.
"Because he doesn't need me anymore," she wailed.
"Oh, Soph, no, you see you got it wrong. He needs you more than ever. This is an exciting adventure for him. He is a very confident young man, strong. I always told you that. You should be proud. I've seen some horrors in my time. Kids hanging on to the clothes of their parents, having to be physically removed to go into school. No, you'll see. He'll be aching for your arms later." Sophy heard the reassuring tone and words and let out a sigh. "Now, is my little Poppy there?" Niall asked.
"I should hope so, and that she hasn't skipped off into school as well."
"Well, won't be long, will it? Couple of years."
"Niall, stop it. You were doing so well."
"Oh, right, sorry. Yeah, no, Pops is tiny. Loads of time with her yet. Put her on." Sophy rolled her eyes but obliged Niall and handed the phone to Poppy, who at 2.5 held it very steadily and proceeded to engage in conversation with her daddy. Sophy looked on, fascinated by the whole process, the very fact that Niall was asking after his daughter and wanted to engage in conversation with her, even though she was only 2, still amazed her. But the fact that Niall had called and asked after Max, who was not his son, warmed her heart so much. She knew she wouldn't hear from Jeff until much later, if at all, and that he would simply send a text, something short and arrogant, with reference to Max being his son. He still felt he needed to assert that parental authority over Niall over 3 years later. Jeff's ego was well and truly bruised. He knew he couldn't be the father Max needed him to be, and he was clearly missing Debbie, but would never admit it. Debbie had obviously seen him for what he truly was, the way Sophy had. Sophy found it interesting that she had been with Jeff for around 4 years. Debbie didn't quite manage 4 years in the end. Sophy had clocked Jeff's new Instagram photo. An image of him topless and tanned, wearing aviators, holding a beer, with that smile that had seduced her all those years ago. He hadn't been able to be the partner that Sophy had needed him to be, and it was only once she was well and truly out of that relationship and had begun to let Niall in that she began to see some of the gaping differences between them. With Niall, she truly knew what a real man was and what being a father to her son looked like. Max may be Jeff's biological son, but Niall had made his mark on Max's heart a long time ago. In Sophie's eyes, it was Niall who was his real daddy.
"Mama!"
Poppy was holding the phone in the air at Sophy.
"Oh, thank you."
Sophy looked at the screen, but Niall was no longer on the call.
"Did you hang up on Dada?" Sophy bashed out a text denial. Think Pops hung up on you. I love you. Thank you for checking up on me and for the reassuring words. I'll see you later. Kiss. Sophy began getting her stuff together, ready to walk home, when Niall texted her back. Oh no, she said bye and everything, and ended the call. I love you too. Kiss. Sophy looked at Poppy, who was swinging her legs and twirling her hair around one finger. You're a funny little thing, aren't you? And she began pushing the pushchair home. Home was a three-bedroom semi-detached in Putney, a house that she and Niall had chosen and bought together as soon as she'd found out she was pregnant with Poppy. The mortgage was astronomical, and they would be paying it off until they were 70, but it was worth it. It had three nice-sized bedrooms, wooden floors throughout, an open-plan kitchen diner, and a garden that was big enough for Max and Poppy to run around in, with a shaded patio area for reading and relaxing, and where Sophy could sit and watch her children play. Occasionally, Sophy would wonder what it would be like to live in a bigger property, out in the countryside, somewhere with a utility room and a boot room, with a garden that led onto the woods. She knew Niall would love that too. When Sophy had been with Jeff, she had often daydreamed about what else she wanted. A bigger house, nicer furniture. But not once since she and Niall had bought this house had she felt she needed anything else. Except for maybe one thing. But she wasn't sure if she was ready to tell Niall that yet. Chapter 2. Aisha. The house felt strange without the twins in it. And it wasn't because Aisha wasn't used to having time without the boys. It was because Aisha knew they were at school. It was a milestone, something she had battled with for years. The notion that one day it would be here, not wanting time to go past, but also feeling desperate for her freedom. It felt like a lifetime ago when Aisha had met Sophy and Mel outside the village hall. She had been battling depression after having her twin boys, Otis and Jude, and trying to deal with her emotions alone. Suddenly, having the girls around and being instrumental in bringing to life the 3am Shattered Mums Club had given her back the confidence she had forgotten she had. Now, 4 years on, she was filled with an overbearing sense of guilt. Christ, when would it end? The twins had started school today and she was still filled with guilt. Now, because they were at school. Their babyhood was over and she, as well as her girlfriend Charlie, was now mother to two young boys, and the guilt was there because she wondered if she had, at times, wished it all away. She went into the kitchen and did the one thing she had been unable to do properly for so many years. She baked. Because even with Otis and Jude being slightly more independent, they were forever getting into mischief, leaving Aisha with so very little time to do anything. She had lost count of how many times she had begun a job and had to abort halfway through because one of the twins was in a predicament or was about to cause major damage. The boys had gone to preschool 2 days a week, but who could get anything done in 2 days? Aisha would spend the first day just sitting in silence, in total shock that she was alone and that the twins were being cared for. Charlie had grasped the quiet time and disappeared into her recording studio in the basement. Now they would be away for 5 days at a time, and she could almost see time stretching in front of her like a vast ocean, where Friday was a very small island on the horizon. Oh, it felt so good to have the kitchen to herself, with a large amount of time to play with and to achieve multiple things. But there it was, that bloody guilt, creeping in and tapping her on the shoulder, checking in with her, drawing attention to her sudden sense of freedom. When would it end? Perhaps it never would. She had heard that as a parent, no matter how old they get, you never stop worrying. She wondered if that was the same for guilt. She pulled out flour and sugar and baking powder and spices and began making the boys' favourite, sticky gingerbread. She had been so busy with name labels and uniforms the last few days that she hadn't had a chance to do much else. This way, she could stock up the baking tin and even pop some bits in the freezer for emergencies. Whilst the cake was in the oven, her phone rang and her father's name flashed up on the screen. John. She had left his name on her phone how she had put it in there that first week after he came back into her life after 20 years. Even though now she was happy to call him her father again. Hey, Dad, Aisha said as she looked in on the cake, which was rising beautifully.
Just checking to see those boys got off to school okay?
Yes, they did, thank you. Thanks for ringing. Is Mum with you?
Yes, she's in bed though.
Oh. Aisha had been wondering why she hadn't heard anything from her mum this morning. It was unusual, as Aisha had been fretting over the boy's first day for weeks with her mother. She thought it was sweet that her dad was trying to do the right thing and stand in for her mum. Aisha knew that he wasn't interested in how his grandsons had got on walking into school on their first day. It wasn't that he didn't care about them. Aisha had seen some very caring tendencies over the past few years since her father had been back in her life. John still bore the markings of a man hardened by a childhood where kids were expected to get on with things, never allowed to speak up about their feelings, and there had certainly not been any such thing as mental well-being back then. Which was one of the reasons John had gone on to suffer as an adult, before finally finding his way back into their lives. But things had been pretty good over the last 4 years, since he'd come back. The most surprising outcome was the way her mother and father had just picked up from where they had left off, as though the two-decade break was exactly what was required. Their relationship was healthier than it had ever been. 6 months after showing back up, John had moved back into their home in Brixton, and sometimes Aisha could believe that he had always been there. But the echoes of the last 20 years were in every nook of the old house, and would often sneak back out to greet her, reminding her that John wasn't a part of all their memories. Aisha would remember when Martina would creep off to her bedroom and cry silent tears, which Aisha would hear through the wall of the bedroom she shared with her two sisters. But he was making up for lost time, and here he was, letting her know her mother was unwell. Is she okay?
I'd say it's just a cold. She always used to get them after you kids went back to school after the summer holidays. Do you remember? It was like she had used all her energy up with your sisters and your cousins, and then she crashed. I reckon she's done the same thing this time with the boys.
Oh no, Aisha thought. Had she managed to burn her poor mother out with the twins over the summer holidays? It had been a long, hot summer, and Aisha had wanted to do so much, as they were the last days of freedom before school and routines began. But Martina had wanted to be a part of everything, and had insisted she come on a lot of the excursions Aisha had booked.
Well, can you tell her I will pop by and see her this week? And tell her to stay in bed and rest, and not try and come over until she's better.
I will. All right, give those boys a kiss from us and we'll see you soon.
Bye, Dad.
Aisha ended the call and felt the tears that had been burning in her eyes begin to fall. It had been a tough morning already, what with dropping the boys to school, but there was a tone to her father's voice that she wasn't sure about, as though maybe he was hiding something from her, something about her mother. It didn't matter that the boys were now at school, and she had one or rather two less things to worry about for a few hours a day. Her mother's health now played on her mind. Even though Martina was still not yet even 60 years old and was as tough as a workhorse, Aisha felt the familiar drag of worry, the one that had hounded her for years as the boys grew up fighting off every illness, follow her around for the rest of the day. Chapter 3. Mel. She could sense the mother's descending on her like a pack of wolves. Mel had that look about her, the one that drew women towards her in one of two ways, shy and slow or like a bullet. And there was something about primary school mums that made them want to form clans and bring in as many outsiders as possible. And Mel just knew they were coming for her. She had been here already back in the day when her eldest daughter, Leia, was small. But that was over a decade ago, and Mel did not remember there being nearly as much emphasis on adult participation. She had got away with keeping her head down and not really getting involved. But she could feel the atmosphere in the playground charging. There was an expectation brewing all around her. Everyone wanted a piece of everyone else. Mel almost wished she could go back to when Skye was a baby. She had already forgotten the roller coaster that had been having another baby in her early 40s. Although she and Daz had planned Skylar, it was still a shock to her system, especially when those all-nighters kicked in around 3 months old. She wasn't sure she would have gotten through it if it weren't for Sophy and Aisha and their 3 a.m. Shattered Mums Club WhatsApp group.
Hi, you're Skylar's mummy, aren't you?
Came a voice from behind her, and not surprisingly.
Mel had almost been on tenterhooks, waiting for someone to get their claws into her. There were two women ahead of her that Mel was sure would be the ones to reach her first, but someone had clearly intercepted them and snuck up from behind. The two women in front of her began to back off, defeated by this bolder predator. Mel was being greeted by the most pristine-looking woman she had ever seen. She was sure she actually gasped. The shock of seeing someone so well turned out on a school run almost distracted her from the fact that she had been addressed as Mummy by a grown woman. Only her four-year-old daughter could be expected to refer to her as that. Mel plastered an inane grin across her face. She had tried to prepare herself for this moment. She had hoped it would have been much like it was the first time round, and she could have blended into the background. Mel knew that there had been developments in the world of the school playground mum. This she knew from mum friends who had children a few years older than Skye, but not as old as Leia, her other daughter, who was older by 11 years. They had evolved. There were actual PTAs as opposed to a few mums who always ran the stall at the Christmas fete. And there was a serious expectation to bake the best cakes for the cake sales and to be part of the Facebook group. For the love of God. "I am Skylar's mum, yes," Mel said, asserting herself to the best of her ability, but she was tired. Mel had been feeling out of sorts last night. Maybe because it was Skye's first day at school, which was another milestone to kick off. That was it. No more babies. It wasn't that Mel was aching for another infant to cradle, although she would happily take any of her friends' babies for half an hour, knowing she could hand them back, but because she knew that it was done. She was done. That whole first part of her life. Meet the man, tick. Get married, tick. Have a couple of babies, tick. What was there left to do? They had been so wrapped up in having Leia, and then having Skye, that knowing that raising babies was over made Mel feel a bit redundant. It had come at her hard last night when she had been packing Skye's bag. The feeling, which was a mild fear and panic, had gripped her. Skye hadn't wanted to go to sleep last night either. First day nerves. Skye kept going to check that she had everything in her bag, and then checking that Mel had made the right sandwich for her lunchbox, and Mel had to keep reminding her that she was about to go into reception, and she didn't need anything in her bag. She had chosen a fluorescent backpack from Smiggle, which was half the size she was, and then, of course, needed the entire bundle of lunchbox case, pencil case, and drink bottle to match. Mel had stumbled at the till when the assistant rang up the price. "Are you kidding me?" Mel had almost inserted a swear, but stopped herself in time. "For a kid's rucksack?" The assistant, a young girl not much older than Leia, had looked at her and shrugged. Mel had shaken her head. "How can you sleep at night?" Mel had added as she reluctantly pulled out her debit card and at the same time looked down at her daughter, who was looking up at her with a sweet, coy expression that made Mel's heart almost burst out of her chest. "Thank you, Mummy," Skye had said as they left the shop. And Mel realised that all faith in the universe was restored, and despite extortionate prices of stationery, it was the love from her four-year-old daughter that she wished to add up. Mel assessed the woman in front of her again. Mel took pride in her appearance, and had even thought long and hard about her outfit this morning. She went for her best red berry yoga pants and grey sweatshirt. But this woman was dazzling.
"I'm Saskia."
Saskia flicked her hair wildly, then she leaned in closer conspiratorially.
"Me and some of the mums are thinking of starting up a WhatsApp group."
Saskia's eyes widened with intrigue, as though it were Mel who had just told her that piece of information.
"How fabulous is that?" Saskia said smugly.
Mel felt the hairs on the back of her neck go up, as though she were watching a horror movie, and the lead female was about to walk into an abandoned house. "Don't do it," came the words catapulting through her head. Mel was a contented member of two WhatsApp groups. One with her, Daz, Daz's parents Irene and Mike, and Leia, who at almost 16 felt she was an adult and didn't want to miss out on any family gossip. Then there was her beloved 3am Shattered Mums Club, still going strong after 4 years, although not so many 3am chats these days. And that was enough. That was all she needed. She'd heard stories of mums entering into what they believed was a harmless WhatsApp chat group, only to be bombarded with hundreds of messages a week. And Mel was not going to join a chat group, just to end up as one of the quiet ones who looked at all the messages but rarely involved herself. Because in reality, that was the very opposite of who she was, and so she wasn't going to display some watered-down version of herself on a messaging app. Mel looked the woman up and down in that briefest of ways that most women would have totally clocked. Saskia seemed oblivious.
"My son is Finn," Saskia continued when Mel didn't automatically respond to the WhatsApp group comment.
Saskia cocked her head as if Mel should know who Finn was, but Mel was terrible at names at the best of times, and even more so when she was trying to match the faces to the names of boys who were all 3 feet with short hair.
"Yes, Finn, my little miracle baby. I wasn't sure I would ever conceive, and then voila, there he was."
Saskia was offering far more information than Mel was ready to receive at this time of the morning. Then Saskia leaned in towards Mel.
"I say, us first-time geriatric mums need to stick together, don't we? We're still in the minority, after all. Need to show these whippersnappers that we have just as much energy as they do, plus twice the lifetime of experience."
"Oh, Skye's not my first." Mel looked over at her Skye, who was playing on the bars. "I have a 15-year-old daughter as well." Mel couldn't get that piece of information across fast enough.
"And a 7-year-old Labrador who sometimes thinks she is human."
Saskia snapped her neck back and looked momentarily perturbed.
"Oh, well, get you. You will have to teach me a few things. Let me know what I have coming."
Finn. Where had she heard that name before? Then it hit her. Skye had gone to the nursery next door to the school for 2 years, 2 days a week, but Daz had always been the one to drop her in the mornings, as the start times coincided with his working hours. Mel would swoop in at around 4:30 and collect her, rarely seeing any of the other parents or carers, and Skye would rattle away in her pushchair about things she had done that day. Finn was a name Mel had heard Skye mention more than once, and never in a nice context.
"Finn bent my finger back. Finn bit me. Finn called me a poo-poo head."
All the complaints suddenly came back to her at once, words she had neglected to really hear at the time because Mel had been processing her own thoughts at preschool pickup and Skye's voice had been a background sound to them. There was always one child who was the class bully, and it seemed Finn was the one. And now his mother Saskia seemed to want to be her friend. Oh, this was not going to work. This was not going to work at all. 5:45 p.m. Sophy.
"Well, I was a ruddy mess, cried like a baby in the playground, and when I got home and read the poem that came with the tea bag, my God, that was it. I was a puddle on the floor, an actual puddle."
5:51 p.m. Mel.
"Tea bag? Bloody tea bag. We at least deserve a flipping can of gin or something for the last 4 years we've just endured. You've got a box of tea bags in your cupboard, I presume, Sophy. It's quite condescending, isn't it?"
5:55 p.m. Aisha.
"It's a token gift, Mel. I was the same as Sophy. Bit of a mess, then not sure what to do with myself all day. I baked in the end, and now have 6 loaves and tray bakes. I think the teabag thing is a nice gesture. It's just their way of saying go home, put your feet up, and don't worry about your little one. They will be safe with us."
6:01 p.m. Mel.
"It's their way of saying we're suckers for introducing our kids into the system. She's now on her way to becoming another brick in the wall. You know, I actually considered homeschooling her. Well, the thoughts are still fierce. I will see how reception goes for her, but already there was this mum, called me geriatric when she was clearly several years older than me. Anyway, her Finn is a little bully, and she is trying to bosom buddy with me. I had to feign a phone call when she tried to get my number off me. Please tell me none of you are in WhatsApp groups already."
6:02 p.m. Aisha.
"No, no way. I'm not going down that road. I'm in enough with you and all my family."
6:04 p.m. Sophie.
"Absolutely not. You will not be catching me signing up to any flipping WhatsApp groups."
Chapter 4. Sophie.
"So that's 367 at the end." The woman that Sophy had just come to know as Blythe was tapping her mobile number into her own phone. "Great. I'll set the group up this afternoon and then hopefully we can think of some ideas to help the PTA out.
And, well, it's just so much easier when there are lost PE kits and we want to organise a play date, and my goodness, I just don't know how we managed without WhatsApp before.
Blythe wittered on, and Sophy felt a pang of sadness for the woman. It was her default emotion, and the one that got her in trouble a lot. She ended up feeling sorry for people and saying yes to things when she really didn't mean to. Once Max had reached about 8 months old, and she had begun to wean him off the boob a little, she noticed the damn trait came back into play in full force. No sooner was one person a little less reliant on her than she felt she needed to give that small part of herself away to someone else. And now Poppy was 2 and a half and her own little person, and Max was at school. Sophy did have a little more time to herself, in between school and nursery drop-offs, and doing all the bits she did for the 3am Shattered Mums Club. She had once heard someone say, "If you want something doing, ask a busy person." And that was a motto Sophy felt she lived her life by, as she was usually busy but always found she got things done. As much as she complained and longed for endless days doing nothing and not having to think about anyone but herself, she felt she needed to be busy to justify something. She wasn't sure what, her very existence maybe. Growing up with a lot of siblings in a tiny terraced house with so much going on and never really being able to get a minute's peace would do that to you, she supposed. As much as she hated to admit it and wished she could be someone who was happy doing nothing, she enjoyed a certain manicness to her life, that notion that another deadline was looming on the horizon.
"Thank you, Blythe. I'm looking forward to hearing from you," Sophy grinned.
"And you too. Don't think I don't know all about you and your Shattered Mums Club. I want to be a part of that. I have 4 kids and I think I deserve an accolade sometimes."
"You have 4 kids?
To Sophy, Blythe looked about late 20s, and because Sophy was never backwards in coming forwards, she just asked, "How old are you, if you don't mind me asking?" Blythe laughed. "No, of course not. I get asked this a lot. In fact, I only just stop getting asked for ID when I buy alcohol. Well, it's been 6 months since I was last asked, so who knows? Anyway, I'm 34.
"Wow, I did think you were in your 20s, though."
Sophy felt a pang of envy at this woman, who was 3 years younger than her but looked 10 years younger. Sophy had found it hard slipping towards her late 30s. She had just given birth to Poppy, and the hormones, plus a bout of postnatal depression, had meant she had catastrophized over hitting 36. Even though she had Niall now, even though she was a successful businesswoman, even though it appeared on the surface she had nothing to worry about, the black dog had still come to stay. Niall had been immensely supportive. He'd watched his own mother go through it with 3 of his siblings, while she tried to figure out how to feel a little bit more like herself again. Aisha had been an absolute diamond too, because she had been through it with the twins, although she admitted it wasn't as acute as Sophie's suffering. And, of course, it was up for discussion on the 3am Shattered Mums Club podcast and socials once she had felt ready to talk about it.
"If only we could all admit this is how we are feeling when we are actually going through this," Sophy had said, trying to hold back the tears, but failing. And before she knew what was happening, all 3 of them had been bawling on the recording, and Mel had suggested they cut that bit, but Aisha said it sounded the most authentic thing they had ever recorded. And so it stayed, and because it was talked about so much on social channels, it became the most listened to episode so far. There was something to be said about speaking the absolute truth on certain subjects. But Sophy was always wary, no matter what the response, which was usually positive on most topics she tackled. She never wanted to cross that invisible line and end up offending people. She was acutely aware of the power she had and how she could not only abuse that power, but end up caught up in topics that she wasn't happy to discuss. Not yet, anyway. Maybe in another 10 years. Sophy was still in the baby zone, and as much as Mel enjoyed talking about her perimenopausal symptoms, she found she still couldn't relate to that next phase of life. She sort of hated herself for feeling that way, and how she would sometimes close down whenever Mel began waxing lyrical about unwanted facial hair and a dry vagina. Maybe deep down, Sophy knew she wasn't ready to give up on the idea of bringing new life into the world and becoming a mummy all over again. Still, 38 was no age. She certainly still felt young, no aches or pains to report just yet, but there was something about coming into your 30s when you suddenly started to compare yourself age-wise to other people in their 30s, Sophy found, which was not something she had ever done in her 20s. She looked at Blythe, her youthful exuberance oozing from her in bucket loads. 4 children and not one line on her skin or grey hair on her head, and she looked ruddy and pink-cheeked, without a scrap of makeup, as though she belonged on a farm, her brood of young children trailing behind her in cast-offs and faded wellies.
"Anyway, can't wait to have you on board."
Blythe looked as though she were having some sort of convulsion as she spoke, but then Sophy noticed a small child, a little bigger than Poppy, yanking at her mother's arm and making her jolt back and forth. An inane smile remained on Blythe's face the entire time, and Sophy silently applauded her patience.
"Well, let's see how it goes," Sophy began. "If you could bake a cake for the autumn fete at the end of this month, that would be great."
Blythe spoke before Sophy could turn and walk away.
"Just a nice chocolate one, or chocolate cupcakes. You know, gluten-free if you can, but no worries if not.
We have a Victorian sponge and a lemon drizzle." Blythe looked up to her right, trying to recall what cakes were being baked by others.
"But chocolate is always the favourite, isn't it? And so easy to make. I can send you a recipe if you're stuck."
She smiled at Sophy. So easy? She could send a recipe? Well, if it was so damn easy, why wasn't Blythe making the flaming chocolate cake herself? Sophie's face took on a look that said absolutely no bother whatsoever.
"Great."
She forced the word out through a rigid smile.
"I want a snack," Max said as they began the 10-minute walk back home, Max's hand firmly in hers.
Her whole body was tense from the Blythe interaction.
"I would like a snack," Sophy corrected her son. "You want a snack too, Mummy?" Max said, completely missing Sophie's point,
and if she hadn't been so tense from having just joined a WhatsApp group and assigned herself the role of chief chocolate cake maker, then she could have laughed. In fact, she was more likely to cry, because Sophy knew from experience that once you proved yourself capable of something, it became your signature, the thing that everyone would ask you to do over and over. Sophy was no Mary Berry, but she could cobble together a half-decent bake when she put her mind to it. She couldn't do a shoddy job and face the disappointed face of the rest of the PTA, whoever they were. She was sure she would soon find out. And she couldn't do an exceptional job and become Sophy, the one who makes the most delicious chocolate cake that's so moist.
"Max,"
she looked down at her son, his little fist tight in hers.
"You must say please."
"Please," Max muttered. Christ, was he his father's son or was this just an age thing? Sophy knew she was more annoyed with herself for everything that had just happened in the playground, for allowing herself to join the WhatsApp group in the first place, and then straight away sign herself up for baking duties. Her frustration did not lie with Max's lack of manners over a snack when he was clearly verging on hangry. Why hadn't she just said no to Blythe? She really didn't have the time to be in a primary school WhatsApp or make cakes, and even though she had lived by the idea of asking a busy person when you wanted something done, she began to feel a surge of panic as she thought about these extra things on top of everything else she did. Mel was going to be so disappointed in her as well when she found out about the PTA group chat. She really felt as though she was about to start cheating on the girls with other mums.
"Mummy! Snack, snack, snack!" Max chanted, and then Poppy joined in. "Oh, for goodness sake!"
Sophy stopped abruptly and Max's arm yanked where he had begun holding onto the buggy, which was their one rule of walking to and from school where the roads were so busy, her hand or buggy. Walking anywhere with Max gave Sophy a heart attack. She had always loved London, but just recently she had begun to get slightly panicky whenever she was near a main road. And when she saw other people's children racing down the street meters ahead of their parents on scooters, she would have flashes of images through her head that she did not wish to see. She thought again what that life in the countryside might look like for her and Niall and Max and Poppy, but she always seemed to move away from it. Yet it hung around in the background, nudging her from time to time, especially now when she had to stop in the street and she could feel the force of every vehicle that went past and exactly how much damage they could do. She pulled out 2 packets of raisins from her bag and handed one each to Max and Poppy. She slowed down the pace and watched Max as he carefully picked out one raisin at a time and observed how Poppy did the same. Was that a trait that they had both inherited from her? She found it difficult at times to distinguish between things that her children had inherited from her and what was from their fathers. Sometimes she hated that she had 2 children with different dads. She didn't mind it when she saw or heard it happening with other women. In fact, she was supportive and in awe that they had gone on to find happiness with someone else. But she now felt that Jeff and Niall shared an equilibrium which she wasn't entirely comfortable with. She needed the balance tipped so that she had more children with Niall than she did with Jeff. Then maybe she wouldn't feel like a label or someone who has a child with every man she gets with, which was a terrible put-down even to herself. But she couldn't help how she felt. But at the same time, as easy as Poppy was, she wasn't sure she or Niall were ready to have three children. There was the size of the house to think about for a start. This was perfectly illustrated when Sophy walked through the front door of their home and the shoes were so piled up in the hallway that she struggled to get the pushwear through. "Damn it," Sophy cursed as one of her espadrilles became caught under the wheel of the buggy. She had meant to tidy them before she left for the school run. Max diligently bent down and pulled, with some effort, until it was free and Sophy began pushing the buggy into the kitchen. She bent down and took the slightly squashed shoe from her son and at the same time felt like she was really seeing him for the first time in days. Something in the way he had picked up the shoe and was now looking at her, her small, handsome man, made her feel again as though he wasn't her baby anymore. Sophy only knew she was crying when Max started wiping the tears away with both hands, his little palms cupped across her face, and she began to grin through the tears and then pulled his little body into her. He smelled like school, a mix of blue paper towels, disinfected toilets, and cooked lunches. "Oh, Max, I love you." She held him tight, trying to imprint this moment to her memory, because she was suddenly terrified of the days rolling into one, the way they had this week, and she would miss it all. "I love you too," he replied, and although she had heard those words 100 or so times, it still made her heart leap and her stomach flip. Their loving moment was perforated by the beeps of several messages coming through one after another. Sophy reluctantly released herself from the moment to check her phone. It was coming from WhatsApp, and Sophy hated that technology had invaded such a tender moment, but Max was already heading off to play with his Lego. She popped the buckle on the pram, but Poppy stayed put, still eating her raisins. Sophy took her phone out of her pocket and saw it was the group chat that Blythe had created. "Hey, ladies." "Oh, no," Sophy said out loud. She detested being referred to collectively as ladies, specifically from a woman. Sophy couldn't put her finger on why, but if she had to guess, she would say it was because it usually sounded so false and forced. Like in situations like this. "Here we all are, then, in this group chat. Enjoy, and I'm sure I don't need to remind anyone to be kind and courteous. I've met all of your little ones, and they are all a credit to you." Sophy did a fake vomit noise, which attracted Max's attention. Sophy grinned and he grinned back. He was at that age where involuntary bodily noises were the highlight of his day. The beeps kept coming, and Sophy inwardly groaned this time, not wanting to alert Max's attention to her emotions again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.